We're now joined by Lito Alveria Jr., Government Systems and Processes Expert of Secure Connections. Hi, Lito. Welcome back to Market Edge.
Good morning, Michelle.
So, yeah. Lito, I'm very curious. Have you registered? I mean, how was your experience?
No, I haven't tried registering. I knew that there would be a deluge of registrants. As we've seen yesterday, you know, there were some problems encountered by the telcos in the registration process.
I haven't registered either because I'm postpaid, so I'm just waiting for my telco company to send me a confirmatory message to reconfirm my identity. But let's talk about the registration of, you know, SIM cards, mandated by law. It's actually norm in over 150 countries around the world. How has it been effective or ineffective in other countries? Are there lessons we can learn from the experiences of others?
Well, there are countries that had actually repealed the SIM card registration because of problems that have cropped up, you know, in the process. New crimes were spawned by SIM card registration. For example, there was a lot of, you know, the black market for SIM cards grew in some jurisdictions. Cell phone theft is another example, no, of cases that have been on the rise since SIM card registration. So there are a number of countries that have actually repealed the law already.
Lito, so it's a digital by default. What are some of the issues? What are some of your thoughts on the ongoing SIM card registration? I imagine there are still many questions in your mind. What should we be asking and thinking about today?
Well, the problem with the platforms, okay, the implementing rules and regulations require that the telco set up their online platforms for registration. And that's digital by default. So it doesn't provide for other users. So, for example, there's still users of feature phones. No, so I wonder how many feature phone users there are out in the field, out of about an estimated 170 million SIM cards out there, right? So how will these users register their phones? Well, of course, by default, they can go to the outlets of the telcos, you know, but it's not provided for in the IRR.
And when you say, Lito, just very quickly, feature phones, what exactly do you mean by feature phones?
Oh, it's the, let me show you. I still use it.
Ah. Oh, here. Okay. The more old school, traditional, not smartphones. The non-smartphones.
Yeah, non-smartphones. All it's right. For talk and text features, no? So that's a feature phone. So I use it. I still use it because it affords more anonymity. Now this time, well, the SIM card registration, I will not be anonymous anymore. You know, prepaid cards.
All right.
So that's another thing that we lose. It's the anonymity. Okay. I'm pretty sure there are others who use feature phones. No. You know, for purposes of calling and texting their relatives, friends, and just to stay connected.
And speaking of anonymity, this could be a big loss or a potential loss for celebrities who want to, you know, stay under the radar, even journalists who would like to conduct their inquiries, you know, with anonymity. So I imagine this would be a big issue for them. Going back to the registration itself, I'm curious how accurate you think the information can actually be. I mean, I can be a criminal and register a SIM card with a stolen ID, right?
Not only that, fabricated ID. The IRR provides that barangay IDs, for example, are acceptable forms of identification, right? And we know how lax, there's really no control, no? Verifying the identities at the barangay level. Okay, so anybody can just get a barangay ID, and these are simple IDs. They do not have any security features at all, right? And anybody can just create a barangay ID and claim to be from a particular barangay, using, of course, maybe fictitious names to register.
I'm actually looking at the information that individuals will need to log in: their name, their birthday, gender, address, nationality, plus that ID. We know that the telcos will be registering the data for us. Will the telcos also be the ones to keep the data?
The telcos are required to respectively store the data in their own servers.
So the government will have no access to the data?
That's not an absolute condition, right? The government may have, especially law enforcement authorities, maybe subject to the orders of the proper court, no, to get the data about the SIM cards.
And how secure are the systems of our telco giants to ensure that their storage won't be hacked and our information won't be compromised?
Of course, they are duty-bound to secure the servers and the database, right? We're pretty sure that the telcos are securing their networks and their facilities against any unwanted intrusion into their systems. But there's no 100% guarantee, security guarantee. The perpetrators or cyber criminals always finds a way. They always find a way to break through the security barriers.
And here's the thing, Lito. If I'm registered, if my SIM card has been registered, will I know if my data has been pulled out by any court, by any government agency? Will I be informed that somebody pulled out my information from the SIM card registration storage?
That's the thing, okay? It says that the data may be provided. The IRR and the law say that your data may be acquired for lawful purposes and only upon your consent, okay? But what if law enforcement or some other agency is doing surveillance? They may not necessarily reveal to you your data has been requested, no, by any agency conducting surveillance.
All right. And for how long will they be holding my information?
There's nothing in the law nor in the IRR that says, you mean holding the information by telcos?
Yeah.
Well, telcos can keep your data forever for as long as you're an active user. But if your SIM card is deactivated, I think the period to keep the data about you is about 10 years.
Will this SIM card registration also mean that aside from these telcos storing data about my SIM card, that they can also access, things I do with a SIM card? For example, my phone logs, my text messages, can those be pulled out as well?
That would be another issue, no? Looking into your activities. It can be done. It can be done. It's being done, especially by hackers, cyber criminals. They can track your activities on the net. Okay. So there's no provision in the SIM card registration law that prevents this from being done, by either the telco or law enforcement authorities. But it is being done by cyber criminals.
The social media aspect. I know there was originally a provision for the social media to be included, but that was not included in the final version. Can you tell us more about that? I mean, right now, we don't just really communicate via text message or calls. Many of us communicate via Viber, WhatsApp, Instagram, Facebook Messenger. And these are things that might not necessarily be linked to SIM cards.
That's correct. I think the issue there was a more legal technicality. Okay, there's a rule, I think, in the Constitution about the one title, one subject, for the law, So when that social media registration requirement was inserted in the first version of the SIM card registration law, the former president did not sign the previous law.
Lita, the one of the main reasons why this law was pushed was because of, the spread of so many text scams, spam messages, text messages that were clearly scams, but so sophisticated, they actually already contained the recipient's name. I mean, I'm sure you've received text scams where you were named as Lito Aversian. Do you think this SIM card registration can actually solve that? How effective do you expect this to be in fighting?
There will be other ways. Right after the telcos acted on the prohibiting links, no, to be included in any text message. Okay, so what happened was the scammers found another way of providing for those links. You know, just like inserting, for example, in place of a dot, they would put parentheses and then spell out the word dot, right? Giving the recipient an indication that they have to replace the dot, the word dot first before they can provide the link. So there are other ways, okay? So there was still a proliferation of those. Yeah, you're right. I've received several, even from gambling sites, you know.
With your name on it.
right. So we're still worried about the cases like those would still proliferate. Mm-hmm. In fact, during this registration period, I received a message, you know, asking me to confirm my GCash number. Okay, yesterday, the first day of registration, right?
Huh.
So asking me to confirm because they said, the SIM card registration is ongoing, you know, we have to verify your GCash account, etc.
Thank you for bringing that up, because our numbers are linked to our wallets, to our e-wallets, GCash,
right.
PayMaya, Grab
Wallet. Whatever else, yeah.
So we're not supposed to be receiving those messages yet from these e-wallets, right?
You're not supposed to receive any such message.
So it's only your telco who's supposed to be messaging you if you're postpaid. That's what I saw. For postpaid Globe, you don't need to register. All you have to do is wait for them to send you a message where you can confirm your identity. Because anyway, postpaid subscribers already have submitted their information while applying for the line, right?
Yes. I've seen those messages as well. I'm aware of those messages that the telcos send out.
All right. Lito, any other loopholes, weak links that you're seeing so far in the SIM card registration? And maybe suggestions on how to improve?
Well, just simply don't. Well, for one, for end users receiving text messages or messages like the one that I described, no, just simply ignore them. Do not respond to those messages. Just to avoid being scammed, right? Mm. To improve the system, I guess, well, computing, let's say, there are about 170 million SIM cards out there. That's the estimate, right? So if we were to cut down into half, you know, the prepaid and postpaid, I'm pretty sure the prepaid cards or SIM cards, there's a lot more, no, compared to postpaid. But let's say 50 million cards per telco, right, per major telco. They will have to accommodate about 430,000 registrants a day, okay, because we're only left with what, 117 days more. Okay, because the first 60 days was eaten up by writing the IRR, and the law was supposed to have been effective October 27. Right, so we lost already 60 days in registration period. Mm-hmm. What the telcos could do is increase their hardware resources to be able to accept the number of potential number of registrants that may be coming in every day.
Lito, final question. In other countries, they also do this for foreigners who are buying local SIM cards.
Right.
What about for foreign travelers to Manila? What's going to be the protocol for them?
Oh, they can buy their local SIM cards. From discussions that I attended in the consultation at the NTC, foreigners are not required to, you know, if they're short-time visitors anyway, right? That's the logic there. They need not register the SIM cards. But for those foreign visitors staying for a much longer period, then they will have to register, or they can buy local SIM cards, which would require them to register.
Mm-hmm. And final question. I just thought of this right now. You know, I did hear some stories. I'm not sure if they're confirmed. You know, these guys who send us spam and scam text messages, they're a group of people in a room full of, you know, these tech guys who just keep sending these messages to us. So imagine if there are 20 guys there, that's 20 different SIM cards. Will the telco firms be accountable for reporting, you know, if, I don't know, will the telco firms be able to track if, you know, these SIM cards based on their activity belong to, you know, a questionable group who might be sending scam messages?
Well, for one, telcos can monitor those SIM cards for messages, but of course, you know, contents of our text messages should remain secret,
yeah, but,
right?
I mean, Lito, if those SIM cards are sending 20, 30, 50 messages in a minute or 10 minutes, that's something,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, there's still this device that even individually, right, allows you to send text messages, you know, by batches. Right, so, and using different SIM cards, and that's going to be the problem. Again, well, big telcos are already actually monitoring text messages by detecting links in the messages which they are prohibiting. They're already doing it, and those the contents of those text messages should remain private. No, so that's the issue. Of course, they can use AI and machine learning to detect, you know, how many messages are being sent out by a particular SIM card in a minute. Okay, they can do that. There are technology solutions. Hmm. But then the question of interfering, you know, looking into the contents is another issue. I think it's a privacy issue.
All right.
Right?
All right. So many questions left unanswered. We're just going to have to take it day by day. Lito, pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for making sure, you know, these tech things happen the right way, for monitoring and watching closely how the government rules this out.
Thank pleasure. You.
And Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you too, Michelle.
All right.